On Thursday morning, after days stranded and trapped in the conflict in Sudan, 211 Ugandans finally arrived home, rescued from Ethiopia, where they had managed to escape. The government had worked round the clock to bring them home, sending a Ugandan Airlines plane to pick them up. But 50 still remain in Sudan as the conflict threatens to engulf the nation. Sighs of relief from anxious relatives who had waited impatiently, and tears and hugs as they once again got reunited to their families. Countries continue to rescue their citizens on planes, ships and buses as Sudan natives pray the conflict does not become a full-scale war. More than 500 people have been killed since battles erupted on April 15th between the forces of Army Chief Abdel Fattah al-Burhan and his number two, Mohammed Hamdan Daglo, who commands the paramilitary Rapid Support Forces. They have agreed to multiple truces, but none has effectively taken hold as the number of dead civilians continues to rise and chaos and lawlessness grip Khartoum, a city of 5 million people, where many have been cloistered in their homes, lacking food, water and electricity. Tens of thousands of people have been uprooted within Sudan or embarked on odious trips to neighboring Chad, Egypt, South Sudan and Ethiopia to flee the battles. The latest three-day ceasefire, due to expire at midnight on Sunday, was agreed upon on Thursday after a mediation led by the United States, Saudi Arabia and the African Union, plus the United Nations. During a briefing in Juba, South Sudan's acting Minister of Foreign Affairs and International Cooperation, Deng Daudeng Malek, said that he hoped the extension of a repeatedly broken ceasefire in Sudan would be a chance to foster talks between the two rival forces.
Al-Burhan, in a call with President Salva Kiir Mayardit, gave his initial acceptance of the initiative. We are yet, and of course, we have also sent a similar written request both to His Excellency Burhan and also to the leader of RSF, written one, we have sent to them both. Of course, last night we have heard the RSF have responded in accepting the ceasefire.
Our team spoke to journalists and foreign news analyst Wanyama Wanga on what the Sudan conflict means for East Africa.
Political parties in a particular region, they need support structures. Now, Sudan, for example, is in a very is an African country, but it is also in the Arab League, and it behaves more like an Arab country. And the support in terms of building political structures from the Arab world, I think, is limited. Mm. I think the country which would have the strongest influence on Sudan is actually Egypt.
Are these two men, like I've told you, they were allies. Mm. So if they were allies, what are they fighting for? I see there are maybe two, three things. One, of course, is usual power. Mm. But then Karl Marx says that the economy is the base and politics is an expression of the economic base. So nobody wants power for its own sake. No, power goes with resources. And these people in Darfur, they were engaged in extraction of gold and diamonds. Mm. And they have also been controlling the petroleum, the flow of petroleum, the petroleum trade. Mm. So these two big generals have been having that kind of access to resources. So you can imagine they were paid from their own government. They went to Houthis in Yemen. Mm. They were paid as mercenaries maybe, or foreign troops. Mm. Now, but they also had access.
From the history that you're giving us, Major, it